we're going to kick our time off just reflecting on some of the questions and also the talk that Ed has been giving so far, which has been incredibly helpful. The first one is, someone says, I notice your reference that that you used in the New York Times and the Atlantic. And is it possible that the new digital media, podcast, YouTube, et cetera, that we are missing a cultural source that may know our culture more accurately? And would you, would the younger generation even use these sources today?
Yeah, no, for sure. I just use as framing examples of something to explain the cultural convulsion. I think one of the things that's happened is, and we have to just sort of get used to, is that there's been a shift in the way people obtain and process information. And so people can live their whole lives in a, in a sphere, don't use the word sphere after Vince Bacote, but in a context where they're having information that comes from a community that often aligns with them. So I think one of the things I would say too, I think it's good to read more broadly than just one lane of the information superhighway. I read things to the right of me and things to the left of me and things that I think are more straight news. So I get a picture and a feel for what's going on. So I think we've passed the edge of reality when Walter Cronkite could say, and this is how it is. Well, it's not really how it is. It's how Walter Cronkite saw what it was and CBS News saw what it was. And I think there are now 1,000 people saying this is how it is. The difficulty is facts still matter and should still matter. And they don't in some places. I really encourage you, there's a helpful graph at Ad Fontes, F-O-N-T-E-S, that actually tracks and rates news sources by their left and right leaning. They got a great graphic, and by their focus on facts versus opinion. And I really think it's helpful. And pretty much everybody's on there. You can see all the different things and say, okay, well, these people, when I read them, I know they're to the left, and I know they play loose with the facts. That helps me. And when I read these people, I know they're to the right, and they don't play loose with the facts, or they do play loose with the facts. So what I would say is read broadly, don't take all your news from one lane, and recognize that that there are biases. I think for a few decades, we wanted to pretend that people could be without bias. And I think now we're sort of, no, everyone's got some bias. Let's just know what it is before we step into it.
Everybody's kind of in that echo chamber, right? They're all kind of listening to the same people who think and talk like them, and they're getting reinforced, and you can almost feel the temperature in the room rise up, especially in some social media settings.
Well, that's interesting, too. One of the things that's interesting is when the last few elections, when somebody gets elected, what people say is, I don't know anybody who voted for the other person. Yes, that's true. You don't. But because you're in an echo chamber, so they assume that, something nefarious happened. No, you just don't know anybody who thinks differently than you do because you maybe muted them on Facebook or blocked them altogether or you defriended them. But I really do think it's helpful. I really find Tim Keller's approach, not Tim Keller's approach alone, but he says, if you're going to disagree with somebody, first state their argument in a way that they would say, Micah, he understands what I'm saying. And I think that's an important, just a question of character. And I think that's an important thing for us to do. So if you want to as someone who's very convictionally pro-life, parts of me I don't understand how anybody would not see life in the womb as made in the image of God, worthy of dignity and respect. And so I want to understand why people would come to a different conclusion. It hasn't changed my mind. It does help me maybe to try to explain to them why I think that's a wrong conclusion. But I think knowing the way other people think is a good thing for us to do. And I think it's a Christ-like thing to do.
So one of the questions, Ed, that came in was, as we kind of exegete this cultural moment, we all realize that the pandemic has kind of acted like an accelerant. Things just moving at such
like
a convulsion fire. That you talked about, such a fast pace. At what point is it cultural change or convulsion, or is it just news? That was one of the questions raised.
At what point is it just news?
Yeah, in other words, it's not necessarily going to be a cultural change. It's just something blip across the screen, and we're just getting those fast and furious.
Yeah.
But it's not necessarily reflective of a cultural change.
I think it's got to be not just news for a story or a day or story or what it may be. So, for example, I don't think that inflation is a cultural convulsion. Mm-hmm. But if 4 or 5 months from now, we're still at this point, it's going to have huge implications for people on fixed incomes. It's going to have huge implications for so right now it's news, but it can become, it is becoming, I mean, it's a big deal, but it is, so something when it is protracted, when it stays, when it changes people's patterns and behaviors, then it becomes, I think, part of the bigger cultural convulsion. So I would say our current economic situation is crisis level, but it could get a lot worse. And I think there's a pretty good chance it will get a lot worse. Now, again, I'm not an economist and I don't play one on television, but it's not going well.
So what do you think about what does the harvest or conversion look like for the nuns?
A harvest or conversion look like for nuns? Yeah, that's a good question. I think ultimately one of the things we have to recognize is the process of conversion is elongated for people who are farther from religious faith and practice. Now, again, I believe in, again, I'm going to get very technical here. I teach this at the graduate level. So I believe in punctiliar conversion. So punctiliar conversion is the idea, and it's a uniquely evangelical idea. It's not probably the way people taught as 1,000 years ago, but it's the idea that on Tuesday morning, I was dead in my trespasses and sins, as Paul writes in Ephesians, and I've received Tuesday night by grace and through faith, and in a moment in time, I have been converted, and now I'm a follower of Jesus. So I believe in punctiliar conversion, punctiliar point in time conversion, new life in Christ. So that's really important to me. I would say that what's interesting is, for me, punctiliar conversion happened in probably 2 days. I knew enough about religion because, you know, I went through First Communion. I don't think I got to confirmation, so I had some religious background. And when someone said to me, "This is what the Bible says," and I was a young boy, and my life was a mess, as every maybe young boys is at that time. And so I'm just ready, man. So I on August 13th, 1977, I was born again by the power of the gospel. So I still believe people at a moment in time are born again by the power of the gospel. I think what's different is my 2 days of hearing the gospel and becoming a follower of Jesus is much less common in 2022 than it was in 1977 when I became a follower of Jesus. So I think what we're more likely seeing is what I call waves of reconsideration or correction. So, and there's a journey, there's an evangelism journey. So the first thing might be, okay, there's a God. And most people, 81% of people think there's a God right now in America. But then the next thing might be, you know, there's a God and he's active. That's a different thing. You know, a whole lot of people I know believe there's a God, like a divine, you know, clockmaker, watchmaker, and he's sort of out there, they're functional deists. But then there's a God and he sent his son. So that might take me a while to get there and to believe that. You know, if I'm sharing the gospel with a Muslim, I mean, the idea that God has a son is stunning. So each of these things is a reconsideration or a clarification. And in missiology, you have what's called the angle scale. So people start at maybe -8 and -7, -6, -5, and people are starting a lot further back and coming closer and closer. So what it looks like today is probably a longer conversation, probably a conversation in community. Let your church be a place that people who don't know the Lord can come and hear and consider. You can tell them that, you know, Christians are teaching Christians and not everything applies to non-Christians in this setting, but have them be able to hear what it's like to be a Christian, and then they'll be connected to some degree to their community. They're not a member of the church. I believe in what we call regenerate church membership in my denominational tradition, so you have to be a follower of Christ. So I think in community, an elongated conversation is more what evangelism looks like in 2022.
Okay, so relationships are the key there.
For sure.
Yeah. So one of the questions, Ed, is do you think the principle of pruning fits the dynamic shift in the church? I'm thinking about your one-third slide as it talks about people.
Hey, I've been asked that a few times, and I'm a little unsure how to answer, because sometimes I think of pruning as people who fell away because of sin, just because of the context where Jesus uses the words, whereas judgment is involved. And it feels more like just lack of engagement, but it could be. So I think part of it is probably the percentage of people engaged and involved in your church is higher than it was before COVID, partly because you have less people engaged and involved in your church. So I'm a little cautious about using the term pruning, but what I do want to say is to normalize the more robust life in Christ that we see in the front third. And then when we engage that back third and bring them back, hopefully they'll engage at a different level in a more healthier way. But I could see why someone would say pruning. I resist it because I tend to see that more of a judgment passage.
So we know that there's a lot of this controversy around the name, word, however it's used, evangelical.
I've heard that.
And so someone has asked us, how would you reframe it to the people in the pews? Would you have them actively engage evangelizing?
Yeah.
And someone bringing up the fact that there's a bidding quadrilateral
sure.
in influence into the political identifiers or voting, et cetera.
Yeah, so that's a complicated answer. It is what I'm writing a book on. And that's why it's 4 years late. So let me define some terms. So the Bebbington quadrilateral, David Bebbington is a scholar in the UK, and he wrote that there are four things that define evangelicals. And they are crucicentrism, the centrality of the cross, conversionism, what I just talked about, punctiliar conversion, new life in Christ, biblicism, centrality of the authority of the Bible, and activism, both expressing faith and action and evangelism. So. And I actually had the last few years I've been on NPR's Morning Edition several times, and I've actually gone through and explained the Bebbington quadrilateral to a secular audience on NPR's Morning Edition, which was probably the most fascinating interview that I've ever done. And it was, I got this nice text from the producer, who happens to be a follower of Jesus, and she said, I think people heard the gospel on NPR for the first time, and I love to be able to share that. And it was sort of fun. They were very open to the conversation, but it was in the context of what's wrong with these evangelicals. So, and I said, well, here's who we want to be, but here's how often we're framed. Now, I don't think all of it's fair. I think we need to acknowledge that there are people who desire to marginalize evangelicals and make evangelicals sound worse than they are. I can simultaneously think that and say, and sometimes we're not doing ourselves any favors in kind of the person's who we are. So the word evangelical is used by the press in ways, not the press is not a thing, but by some people in the press as a negative, as a pejorative term. It's almost like, matter of fact, Nicholas Kristof, who's a New York Times columnist, very secular, very liberal, wrote a column called Give a Little Respect, and he names this doctor. And he says, when I go around the world, and he's not an evangelical, he's not a Christian, the people I see in the worst places of health crises are evangelical Christians. Have a little respect for these people. So people even see the disrespect. So what I would say is people who are Christians, sometimes, I use the word evangelical to describe myself. I am fighting for the meaning of the word so that it might mean a person who believes those Bebbington things, the authority of the scripture, the men and women need to be born again. It's used among people, the highest people with evangelical beliefs are African Americans, and they use the word evangelical at the lowest level, partly because of its political connotations. So what I would say is you could change the name. So let's say we're not that anymore. Let's just say that we're purple. That's the new name for evangelical. So what are we on purple? Well, the thing is that it still means the same thing if the people are the same people who are those people. So I think what we got to do, and this is what I described on NPR's Morning Edition, there are some things we've got to disciple in. I used the word disciple and explained it. There's some things we need to disciple in to us as a movement. We need to be known for showing and sharing the love of Jesus, for speaking up for the least and the lost, for engaging in hard conversations in winsome ways. We need to do those things. So those things we need to disciple in, but there are some things we need to disciple out. There's this anger. I mean, we've all seen someone go just rogue on Facebook, just constantly, spitting anger and venom at every person that disagrees with them. Then we click on it, and it's someone from our church or it's someone who lists that they're a follower of Jesus on there, and they're just burning bridges. And they say, well, Ed, I'm an American. I just want to be Frank. Well, if your name's not Frank, stop. And if your name is Frank, get it under the lordship of Jesus. So what I would say is, I think we've got to reclaim the word by being the kind of followers of Jesus evangelicals should be. But I don't know for sure that that's going to work. So some people are calling themselves Christ followers instead, or biblical Christians, or Bible-believing Christians. I didn't name my denomination after evangelical, so it's not as big of a challenge for me. But you did, so good luck with that.
Yeah, you Baptists have no problems whatsoever,
exactly,
right?
Exactly.
Right.
No, but I'm at the, you know, I mean, we don't use the term at Wheaton, but people call us the Harvard of evangelicalism. And there's no question that people think of as Wheaton as evangelical at its core, and rightfully so. Those are our doctrinal beliefs. What I would say is I think we need to fix some things. And I wrote an article in USA Today, it was the most read article I ever wrote, called An Evangelical Reckoning. And that may be the title of the book that I'm writing. I'm actually going to go, part of the reason I'm going to go teach at Oxford is I'm going to teach, but part of the reason is I want to step away from American evangelical scene for a while, and I'm probably going to be in England and then some in Australia and try to get, talk about the West and its view of evangelicals as well, and then try to get some input that might help. If you want to come take class with us this fall in Oxford, come on. We'll have a good time.
Yeah, he's advertising.
That's right. All good.
And no, you cannot go over to Oxford and start studying.
You can go. He can't go.
Yeah, I can't go.
And Brad can't go.
Never Brad.
Brad. Never Brad.
So
take over that too.
One of the questions, Ed, someone, speaking of Brad, someone asked the question, could you bring your understanding of generational shifts to this moment?
Okay, someone's heard me talk on that because I have a whole talk on that. And the answer is no, not in the time that I have allotted. Next question.
Okay, fair enough.
No, I'll touch on it briefly. So, you know, one of the things that denominations are asking is, and there's a lot of ways to answer that question. I think that person is probably talking about the denominational shifts within denominations. One of the shifts, so I'm Southern Baptist, like Jesus and all the disciples were.
Does that work in the North?
Do you still call yourself not. Like it? It does not. I only say that because a lot of you are from the South, so you sort of know my. I think most of you know me. Know I'm Southern Baptist. So in 2007, I preached at the Southern Baptist Convention, and I said, "This is the only place that I go every year that makes me feel young and thin." I know. And they invited me back the next year. But the reality is that denominations like mine and like yours have to ask the question, how do we engage the next generation and to value denominations and the denominational family? So I'm a denominationalist. I was speaking at Catalyst one year, and I think Andy Stanley, who's a pastor in Georgia, speaks Catalyst a lot. We were backstage, and he said, You're working for a denomination. At the time, I was working for the Southern Baptist Convention. And he said, you're the only person in this whole room, and we're in the green room, we're speaking today, who still is denominationally affiliated. And he said, why? And I said to him, because all of these other organizations have come and gone. And I could list them. Let's say Promise Keepers. Promise Keepers trying to make a reboot right now. But I could list some of my friends who started major things. Well, here's an example. I mentioned Rick Warren. Purpose Driven was this global influence. And now, I mean, many of you engaged in Purpose Driven stuff, and now not as much. So many of those things have come and gone, and yet institutions like denominations have endured. And so I'm a denominationalist. I wrote the cover story for Christianity Today called Denominationalism, Is There a Future? And the artist, without me seeing it, put a picture of a tombstone, and they carved in, denominationalism, is there a future, on a tombstone. And my article was, yes, there's a robust, vibrant future. And they carved it on a tombstone. Now I edit my own magazine. So anyway. But the challenge is, this room is disproportionately boomer or older Gen Xer. Now, part of the challenge is that it's multifaceted. One of the things is the next generation is valuing networks that are more nimble and are easier to connect with than denominations that have books of order and have confessions and standards and processes and presbyteries. And what I would say is the reason the EPC, you know, it's what are we, the 32nd, is this the 32nd General Assembly?
42nd.
42nd, okay, good. So 42nd, the reason 42nd, and you can list 10 things that have been bigger and caught everyone's attention in the 42nd years of the EPC, and they're all gone, and you're still here. So I think institutions matter and endure, and the processes that they create matter and endure. But I think ultimately you need to ask the question, what do younger generations want? And they want a more network-like gathering. They want their giving to the denomination to feel less like a tax and more like a participation in the mission. They want to be able to see each other and come into a room and see people like them that are on a common mission and a common collaboration. There are things that we can do. And if you're interested, if you just Google Ed's my name and network-like denominations, I've written substantially on this subject. And I think we can attract and see generational shift in denominations, but you're going to have to intentionally engage subsequent denominations. And church planting is a key part of that as well. So the EPCs over the years has been very engaged in church planting, less so at some times. Seven church planters are here applauding right now, and I appreciate all seven of your enthusiasm. But all those things are going to be key to the future. But here's what I want you to hear. If you just think that young leaders will naturally pick up the baton to the next generation of denominational leadership, you're misunderstanding the cultural moment. You need to intentionally cultivate, have a young leader strategy. I work with the Foursquare Church, their Pentecostal denomination, Jack Hayford, you know. I work with them I was their denominational coach for about 10 years, and walk them through a process to bring in next generation leaders. And I'll tell you one of the things they did. You don't have the same polity, so you can't do this. They said everyone who's a delegate to the national meeting needs to bring somebody under 40 with them as an additional delegate to the national meeting. So those kinds of things reshaped it, and now the denomination's healthy, vibrant, with a multi-generation. It was a baby boomer kingdom. That's what they call it, the boomer kingdom. So there's a lot more to be said, but I think generational shift in denominations is a challenging moment, but there's lots of young pastors who are in ARC, the Association of Related Churches, and are in Acts 29, who are in Stadia, who are in Orchard Group. It's not that young pastors are not associating with denomination network-like structures. They're just not associating with some of our denomination network-like structures. Let's ask why. Let's learn from that. Let's do better.
Just to follow up on that, because there's a question that's directly asked as, you know, what mistakes are baby boomers making as they reach out to the next generation?
Forgetting Gen X is the big mistake. Oh, we're so old, us Gen Xers. We're just baby boomers in jeans.
Well, they did include Gen Xers.
Baby boomers. I don't know. I think ultimately, again, I think my goal, if I was EPC leader, which would be terrifying for everybody, but if I took over like Brad has, I think Brad's going to text me some mean things if I keep this up. He's harsh, man. He's hardcore. I think I would acknowledge that most leaders in most denominations entity are baby boomers. Again, if I go to the NEE board meeting at the end of this month, we have an executive team meeting. I think there's one millennial, and I'm the token Gen Xer, and then everyone else is a boomer. I think that makes sense, that over time, you end up in significant places of leadership and you have wisdom. So I think I would say that baby boomers are doing a lot of great things. And I'm very pro what baby boomers are doing and really seeking to preserve, speaking to this. I would say maybe the biggest challenge is not intentionally engaging. And again, I don't want to pick on my Gen X friends. I think ultimately they need to be engaging millennials in key leadership positions and mentoring Gen Z for what one day would be a key leadership position. You know, as I'm 55. So I'm a professor and a dean at a graduate school. And so I get to do this every day. But what I would say is, if you're not in an environment where you're just training students or things of that sort, is find that place. For you boomers who are finishing well, man, it's been a tough few years of people not finishing well. And for some of you who are finishing well, take the time to mentor some Gen Zs and to raise up some millennials. And I think people will respond well to that. You have a lot to offer. And I'm so thankful for some of the older leaders in my life who've spoken into my life. It's been really transformative.
So, Ed, I'd like to spend the last few minutes that we have together turning toward questions related to kind of real practical things about doing evangelism. One of the questions that was raised was about the role of hospitality.
Yeah.
We talked about relationship, but could you expand a little bit upon how hospitality built on those relationships can help us in terms of sharing the gospel?
Yeah, for sure. Can you fire back up that PowerPoint while we're talking? Because that was actually where I was headed, and I'll just throw up a couple of slides. that are actually there. If we can do it. If we can't, it's no problem. But in there, I think part of what for a lot of people, I'm looking to see if I can pull it up here. But if you can, just throw it up there and throw up the last slide we're at, and then we'll go forward a little bit. For a lot of time, evangelism was keep going a couple slides ahead, and I'll tell you when to stop. Keep going. More. We're almost there. Some of you already downloaded it, so keep going here. No, you're going the other direction. I'm sorry. You're supposed to be going back to the rest, the stuff I didn't cover. I apologize. So go click six times. One, two, three. Here we go. One more. Let's see. Okay, so a lot of times we're talking about taking a different approach where, John Dixon, some of you know John Dixon. How many of you know who John Dixon is or read some of his stuff? Anybody? Okay, good. Fun announcement coming about John Dixon today, so just stay tuned. But John, in his book, Bullies and Saints, talks about one of the things that we can do is to engage people kind of where they are a little bit differently. And this might be where some of this relational comes in, is to ask some questions, affirm some things about what people are. Think about the way that Paul does this at the Areopagus. I see that in many ways you're very religious. Even admit, and what John says, John was on this national television program in Australia, and they were talking about all the bad things that Christians did, and John said, oh, those are so true. I've actually could tell you some more bad things too. Because there have been bad things. Says, but at the same time, Christians invented the hospital. At the same time, we speak of women in a very different way, in part because of Jesus treated, and Christians have seen women made in the image of God, worthy of dignity and respect and more. And so I think that's helpful. Go one more slide, one more advanced. And I think it gets this. And so part of it too is to do so in hospitality. If you'll notice here, is we belong to the broader community. Now, belonging doesn't mean, it doesn't mean membership. There is a covenant community that is the church, people who are born again, holding each other accountable and more. But if you'll notice, it's to belong to the broader community, bless the world to reach, and bless is actually an acronym that Rick Richardson in his book, You Found Me, unpacks. And it actually has like over the table, right? Be with people. Bring to the community of the church and build a beloved community through hospitality, which gets back to what you're saying. So hospitality and being shockingly hospitable, radically hospitable to people who deeply disagree, I think becomes a disarming part of a conversation and gives us the opportunity to show and share the love of Jesus in very powerful ways. Yeah, I believe. So again, the whole missional conversation, I think, and again, this is all in Rick's book and in our research project, so you can check it out at You Found Me. You Found Me. So
the next thing that would be super helpful for us, Ed, is that Jimmy Scroggins was here yesterday.
I love Jimmy.
And he...
do you know he has like 70 children? Did he tell you how many kids he has?
Yeah. I thought it was a million.
I know, it's crazy. They wrote a book on parenting, and I had him on my radio show, because I figure if you can have that many kids, what a blessing. I mean,
has eight.
Is it?
I have seven.
Do you know what?
Yeah.
I have three, and I feel left out of the party.
That's right. I'd be happy to give some of mine to you if you'd like.
Yeah.
Welcome back.
Sorry, but go ahead.
That's right. So, Jimmy's turning everyday conversations into gospel conversations, which is translated into
so
this
good.
Three circles.
Yeah.
Jimmy's been super gracious and given that to us, and it allowed us to kind of adapt it to the EPC context. And so we're doubling down on helping to train people on the three circles. Could you give a little shout out for how having something like that kind of a tool could be beneficial once you're in this relationship and this hospitality and you have that
totally.
Opportunity. Tell us how that helps.
Yeah, so tool people and relationship people seem to be like in different streams,
right.
which is
right.
always fascinating to me. Because if you like do EE, right? EE came out of Presbyterian world, not your particular stream, but and yeah, I was trained in EE, and I really would tell you, if you ever look at EE in the recent past, you should. I mean, it's really, they've got fascinating new resources. But they seem like they're like the tool people, and then there's the relationship people. Well, you know, I just want to build relationships, but here's what I found. So if when I was a kid, luggage didn't have wheels. Now stay with me. I know you're like, where in the world does this come from? Stay with me. Because my children, when I told them my luggage didn't have wheels, they're like, seriously? Was the wheel not invented yet? I said, No. We had the wheel, but nobody had put it on a suitcase. I'm like, no. So you carried it? I said, no, we lugged it. That's why it's called luggage. They're stunned by this, right? So why did somebody put wheels on luggage? Because it made it easier to do. Boxes, right? So I'm in the process. My house is on the market right now. I'm selling my house right now. And so we moved a bunch of stuff to storage because you have to stage your house, which basically means you're miserable for the next few weeks because you can't do anything in your own house. But anyway, so we got some boxes. And boxes all have now holes in the sides of them. And my kids are like, well, wait a second. When you were a kid, you didn't have, no, we put our arms around the, now you put your hands in. There are certain things that we're called to do as followers of Jesus, and sharing the gospel is one of them. What we found is that people do better with sharing the gospel when they have some handholds that they can grab a hold of that helps them to do it more effectively. Now, here's the thing. I'm kind of, now, Jimmy wouldn't like this part, but I'm, at the Wheaton College Billy Graham Center, we're actually, we're tool neutral. We love everybody doing, sharing the gospel. So we love Christianity Explored. We love Alpha. We love Evangelism Explosion. We love Three Circles. Now I tell you, I think Three Circles is really, really good for the cultural moment we're in. So when I list the different things, I was early promoting Three Circles. But here's what I think it is. So people get into a conversation, and you know, I, as a spiritual discipline in my life, I ask the Lord and work towards sharing the gospel verbally with somebody at least once a week. Just as I want to have my quiet time, daily quiet time, I want to have a weekly evangelistic conversation. And I've found that when I seek that out and I seek the Lord for wisdom to do that, that I can find those opportunities. What I find is, in the course of those conversations, I'll often take a hold of a handhold. And it might be, you know, well, here's Three Circles. It might, if it's in a napkin, it might be, sometimes it's depending upon where they are in the conversation or in their own spiritual journey. So I think that one of the mistakes that people made, and we all, you know, things we got to kind of all work on and we'll grow towards, is one of the struggles, one of the mistakes that came out of that is because the tool people got everyone focused on the tools, and then there's a backlash to that. It's focused on the relationship. I want you to build relationships. Let me give an example. I wrote about this in my most recent book, Christians in the Age of Outrage, is I actually mapped out my neighborhood, my 8 closest neighbors who weren't Christians, and we made them on a map. Don and I prayed for them, and I sought to build relationships with them over the course of the 4 years that we were neighbors. And I had the privilege of sharing the gospel with, not inviting them to church, I invited everyone to church, all 8 of 8, but I had the privilege of sharing the gospel with 7 of 8 of them. 3 doors down, had the privilege of leading that couple to Christ and baptizing them, seeing them follow Jesus, become key leaders in the church. Behind us, over 2 doors, leading the husband to Christ, who we built a relationship with. Didn't come to our church. Our church was too contemporary for them, but got them involved in a wonderful Bible-believing church. Baptizing couple, 4 door down the other side. Why? Because I built a relationship with them. But in each of those cases, I'd fall back on a tool that I had learned that's just natural for me, because I have shared the gospel in that way so many times. So what I would encourage you to do is to not move away from, well, we don't want to have a one-day evangelism training. Do a one-day evangelism training. Give people the tools. to give people the tools, and then help them to learn how to build relationships so those relationships can lead to evangelistic conversations.
That's great.
I love this kind of conversation, by the way. I love that you're having this kind of conversation. Be encouraged. This is a season. I hear it from many of your leaders across the denomination. This is a season that we can re-engage that evangelistic passion, and I appreciate your passion for it.
Thank you for being with us. Will y'all just show your appreciation again?
Thank you.
As we conclude this time, it is, as we mentioned yesterday and Dean teed us up, the wisdom. Always learning and understanding, and as we take this back to our churches and our parishioners to understand how we may do this more effectively, let's learn from each other. Many of you know that I am the chief collaborative officer of our denomination.
Cool.
And one of the things that I do is try to help us leverage our resources. I try to benefit those things by effectively equipping the saints. Ephesians 4, 11 and 12 helps us to remind ourselves of the fact that there are preachers, there are teachers, there are evangelists. All of us are not gifted in absolutely everything. But as Presbyterians, one of the things, we're connectional, and therefore we should be collaborative.
Come on.
So let us do that. As we leave this place, will you end us in? Terrence was going to come up and give us some instructions.